I would like to invite none other than Mr. Siddharth Zarabi, Executive Director, BTVI. He is going to be the moderator of this leadership forum. Can I have a hand of applause, please? So to welcome Mr. Siddharth Zarabi, I would request Mr. Rajat Banerjee to welcome him with a bouquet of flowers and a shawl. Thank you. Another round of applause, please. Yes. So now I would request all the other panelists, I'll announce the names and they can come and join us on stage. Their names have been written on the placards. So first, I would like to invite Mr. Manoj Shirodkar, CEO for Life. Mr. Dronacharya Chakraborty, Managing Director, Avon, is stuck somewhere, so he's unable to join us. Could I now invite Mr. Satyan Bhatia, Managing Director, IMC. Mr. Anshu Bagai, Managing Director, Genesis. Mr. Jaydeep Abhichandani, Managing Director, Lyconet. Mr. Shishir Cha, country at Tians. A big round of applause, please. Put some energy into it. Our very dear Mr. Amanar Sen Gupta, CEO, Glaze Trading. And Mr. Adolfo Franco, Executive Vice President and COO, US Direct Selling Associations. Over to you, Mr. Zarabi. So we have four, all the tables have one mic, so you can just exchange and there's one mic for you.
Yeah. Thank you very much and good afternoon. I know this is perhaps the toughest panel that is standing between all of you and lunch, and what we'll try and do is to make it simple and easy and not let hunger pangs come in the way of the rest of the day. Thank you very much, IDSA, for putting together this wonderful event. And Mr. Katoch, you managed to get Anurag Thakur. That was a great thing because very clearly your industry needs a lot of support, and that support can come through a government which is now trying to address all sectors, and perhaps that is going to lead to the changes that are required to provide support to your industry. What we are going to do in the next 45 odd minutes that we have, I'll request this entire panel, because we have a very large panel, to offer one headline comment each, 2 minutes perhaps, and I'll try and keep everyone on time here, as to what they think about the future and prospects of the industry, and if there is something that needs to be done. We have seen a report which has captured all the data and statistics. So that's how we are going to do it. I also want to bring in the audience into a more informal question and answer session here. So we'll get one round of quick comments from this entire panel, one headline from each of the panelists here, and then I'll try and take as much time as is available with us for an interactive session with the permission of my panel, because that is going to become really informative and educative. So what I'm going to do is go to the extreme left of the panel first, start with you, and then I'll keep toggling between the rest of my guests here. Over to you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and warm regards to all the panelists. I would like to talk about skill development in the country, which the direct selling companies are doing. I'm talking about areas which are very remote, areas which are the rural part of the country. And we are organizing so many trainings and meetings for the development of the skills, especially the sales and the personality development of the people who are becoming a direct sellers from the rural part of the country, and people who are not even educated, who have not even gone to schools or colleges, and we are going there, reaching their villages and making them successful entrepreneur and giving them an opportunity of not being a laborer and becoming a businessman, which is very important for a direct selling company going and conducting those trainings. So the initiative taken by the government of India, Skill India, I think we are one of the major people who are promoting this scheme, this policy, pan-India, cross-India. So I believe direct selling has a huge, huge contribution towards creating a new skill, India, and giving that opportunity to people.
Thank you, Satyan, and that's a wonderfully important point because that is where employment will come from. I was just having an offline discussion about the impact of online and how do you come up with a hybrid model. Just to tell you, and we can do that offline, there is a dedicated skill development university, the first of its kind, which is coming up just less than 100 kilometers away from Delhi. And I know the vice chancellor there, he's a colleague who perhaps should start, and I'm going to send them as a suggestion after this event, start a specific direct sellers course, and perhaps the industry can come together. I will come to Mr. Franco here. With your permission, sir, after I get some of the domestic voices in, because then I want to get you to give us an international perspective. So I'll come to my colleague here first and then come to you towards the end of the points. Over to you, Manoj.
Hello, thank you. We are here to talk about building new India. And so it's important that we define what new India that we have in mind. In my opinion, it is the mindset. It is a mindset to create a new, better Indian. And what is new, better Indian? It is an individual who has self-confidence and pride for self as well as the country. Now, how direct selling is going to affect to that or help that is something that possibly I will talk as we go into more detail. But this is where direct selling comes to the picture, to create a new Indian mindset to make the new India.
Absolutely, and I think my first experience with direct selling, and because most of you are on the sell side and I am from the buy side, as they say in my trade, from the markets, was the fact that there were a lot of women, self-employed, what would we call housewives, that's a word that perhaps I really don't like it. I think homemakers is far more accurate. And It provided for empowerment of people. And this one case that I recall almost 20 years back convinced me that this was not a pyramid scheme that some people believe it in. And I think one of the key challenges that your industry still has is to do further image correction and brand correction, which all of you are aware about. We can talk about that. Coming to you now, sir, as we...
While 2 minutes will be a short time to describe what the potential it has, but what I can say is that this is one industry which has an impact on all the paradigms which are involved in evolving an economy. Because an economy is not just about what GDP rate we have, we also talk about health of families in it, we also talk about the level of education which the country has. I don't see that which are the aspects that the direct selling industry does not engulf in it, be it the social impact, because when we talk about the participation of a woman in direct selling, I believe that women empowerment is a very commonly used word, but has a huge impact on the social life of the country. So not only it contributes towards the family as economically, but it also improves the health of a family, and all families put together, it's about, we are talking about a healthy country. Clearly it distinguishes us to be, we know that we are into the product segment, so, and we have seen many interviews when we just came in, the videos about MSME contractors who were talking about direct selling companies coming in India and talking about it. So it clearly shows the impact is on the the manufacturers who are waiting for huge orders coming from us. The third is we saw that the largest segment is the wellness segment in it. So I think somewhere we are talking about Healthy India somewhere, where we can easily stitch the entire Healthy India concept to the direct selling companies, which are largely waiting to contribute in this segment as well. And I think when these three aspects come together, are stitched beautifully, think that the political situation in the India has the scope of improvement as well.
Absolutely, and I think the legislative support for your industry is a point that is extremely well taken, and it will continue to be an evolving process. The last 3-4 years have seen changes, perhaps more will continue to happen. I'll now come again to the right of my panel and for your comments.
I think taking a cue from the other speakers, we are talking about Skill India, we are talking about the mindset, we are talking about the $5 million economy. So what is most important to understand is that how we are going to grow and how we are going to, if we occupy this post in the global economy, the 10th position. So this is perhaps the only industry which talks about humans as assets and in fact materials as resources, which you don't find in the balance sheet otherwise, right? So human asset development, because our greatest asset is our network, how we are able to develop this human collaboration, bring up their capacity and capability, upskill them, and of course about entrepreneurship, employment, and giving them the education and the expertise to do all the things. So I think these are my opening comments, that if we have to talk about the growth with values, so what kind of values we in fact profess, how we distribute it in the market, disseminate it, and how we built a good community of direct sellers for us. So those are the most important and key points, because once we talk about brand building, how people recognize us, how we perceive us, because a lot many direct sellers are also around, it's very important that we build our brand in the right way so that more people get attracted toward us, not only in India, but globally. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And that your comments lead me to a question which I'll take up during the discussion, which is, how is technology going to impact your sector? And Mr. Franco can tell us about the international experience once I come to you. Once again, sir, I'll come to my left. And your turn now, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. To add on to whatever has been said since morning, I would say what this industry gives to the youth is exposure to the world. Okay, now, just to give you an example, last week we had an Asia Pacific event in Singapore where there were 6,000 people, and since we are still a startup, we had 200 people from India. Jaws drop. They see what the industry can do for them, what people have achieved in rest of the world. And these are simple people. So many of them are from rural background. Their families don't have the kind of resources which can give them this exposure. They become so ambitious, what they can achieve, what the world has to offer, and along with that, the industry gives them the skill to achieve this. I think this is a priceless thing that this industry is doing to the youth and to the economy of this country.
Again, important point about how dreams and aspirations are being fulfilled by your sector. I'll come to you again and then go to the next guest.
Thanks, Siddharth, and good afternoon, everyone. I'll take a cue from what the minister said in the morning, because he's talking about $5 trillion economy, right? And to unlock that key, because it's not a mean target, because going to $5 trillion, I think, is very aggressive, requires a lot of innovation, and a lot of ownership from every citizen of India. So if that is the lock to be unlocked,
yes.
I think direct selling is the key which fits in perfectly. Because what we have here is young people who are aspirational, trying to do things their own way, and are definitely responsible for the result. So the way I look at it, because there's a very, this government is very positive, very innovative, and that's what our industry has become. So what I also feel is all of us sitting here are, this probably is the best time to be in this industry, and we can only take it up from there. Thanks so much, Siddharth.
Thank you. Best time to be in this industry, and that's a nice way to round up the domestic scenario. And just to sort of tell you, I was at another industry event just a few weeks back, in fact, last month, and the mood was very, 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 very different. And just tells you about how easy we are to please as a nation. Generally, hardworking people, there's a bit of sloth in everyone, but there's no racial stereotyping there. And we are also, I would say, despite all the difficulties and in daily life, also very optimistic people. And I'm glad you said that this is the best time, because those are rare words that you hear from industry sectors in India. I'll now come for the international experience to you, Mr. Franco, and also if you could, apart from your opening comments, relate the where you see the Indian direct selling industry vis-a-vis other mature global markets, because you know comparing India and China and then putting us in baskets is easy, but I really want to use your expertise to get this audience to understand what is the comparison between India and, let's say, the US, for example. Over to you.
Delighted. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you have to hold it a little closer. Do we have use the other one, Sam. Yeah.
This one better?
Yeah, much better. Much
well,
better.
First of all, I want to congratulate the moderator because he did absolutely the right thing. Start out with the domestic terrain, because that's exactly, I could tell you right now that the issues outlined by all your colleagues, it could be in the US, Canada, any place else in the world. So share the same optimism, the same challenges for growth, and the same opportunity that I think that our industry presents to both really distributors and consumers. But I also think, you know, a couple of things, if I may. First, I think today's comments by the minister were extremely important and extremely encouraging from an international perspective, as I will address it from an international perspective, because you know the market domestically. But I think they were extremely important because he was talking about a business-friendly policy and one of investment, tax reform, and openness to the industry and to the entrepreneurial experience. Don't profess to be an expert on India, but I was a history major, so I know a little bit about the history of this country, and traditionally the country has not been perceived as business-friendly as other Asian countries. It's just a fact, or other markets. There's been a great deal of protectionism in this country historically, and as our country, a federal system which makes it even more complicated in terms of the market, the way it operates. So from a foreign perspective, since the vast majority of the largest direct selling companies are foreign, and they're looking to always expand in opportunities, I think the most important thing from a, there's no question about Indian entrepreneurship, drive, potential in this country. But you asked the question, oh, don't put us in baskets with China or other countries in Asia. But you have a country like Taiwan, tiny in terms of comparison to, I should say country like Taiwan, if there's a Chinese audience here, either Republic of China on Taiwan. But when you look at that perspective, is how can Taiwan have be a larger market than India? Yes. And I think that's the question you should all ask yourselves, and I think the minister was actually addressing it. What is the legal, regulatory environment in this country that attracts investment or does not attract it? And I think that is the key. The growth aspects, and a lot of my colleagues here, you know, I know many of your companies, they're American companies, some of them. Yes, the growth and the market strategies and getting people enthused and a huge population is all there. But is the legal regulatory environment one that attracts business? And I think you're making strides in that direction. The growth recently is phenomenal from a low base. The United States, the population of India is 3 times that of the United States. But the United States has 3 times the number of direct sellers. Now that makes no sense, and you have to ask why. And it's not because Americans are more entrepreneurial or there's more opportunity in America. It's what is the environment for doing business in the country. Now you had a great consumer law, you've had a lot, your co-administrator has worked on this law, this we've made great strides, and when I say we, you have made great strides in this country. And very encouraging to have 13 states adopt this, but that's only half, a little less than half of the country. And of course, when you enter into the country, you want to make sure that there is a marketplace that is available for the products for wide distribution with market certainty. At the end of the day, from a foreign investment perspective, capital is cowardly. It only enters markets where there is predictability, where there is stability, and there is the potential for growth. And all of those things are tied in that order. So from the perspective that I bring from the international experience, comparing it to other markets, is if you look at that list of 10 markets in the world, what did they do to attract it? They range from very large countries, of course, in that market,
to very smaller countries, and yet their percentages are huge and they dwarf India. What is different about the ability to do business in those countries than it is in India? And I venture to say it goes back to a complicated federal system here, very empowered states, and even the consumer law, as I mentioned earlier, applicable only in 13 of the states, or adopted by 13 of the states. So I celebrate what's been done. I think it's great to say we're moving in the right direction. But if we really want to get over the obstacles to put India at the top in terms of attraction, those are ultimately the things that need to be addressed fully.
Absolutely, and that's a wonderful set of points that you make, and I'll try and get the audience involved with question and answers. I'm sure people may want to ask you and the rest of the panel here a few questions. You mentioned about great American bands here, and that's the truth about our economy. The real point that you really said is legal and regulatory environment, and I venture to say that after 1991, as we opened up, we took the easiest things that we could do, which was to make changes on paper. And those changes still continue. We are perhaps the only large size economy in the world which has had for the last 30 years, every year, changes to FDI norms. And it sometimes surprises me that if it takes you 30 years and you still have several restrictions for FDI, it means that your thinking as a set of policymakers at the national level and at the subnational regional level, the federal architecture that you're referring to, we are still a work in progress. The easiest reforms have been done. The most difficult reform, which is the mindset of the policymakers, and within that, less the politician and more the bureaucrat who has a 3.5 decade career if he's smart and joined the service at the right time. And he believes in continuity without change. I repeat, continuity without change, and that is a sad reality. A country which is starved of capital should have far easier norms when it comes to doing business. And I argue, and I open up the panel here for questions. Can we get a mic into the panel here? That India has also in the last 5 years gone down the path of not just ease of doing business, but ease of doing honest business. And I think when I use the word honest, I am referring to a set structure that allows the honest, hardworking person safety and security in going around doing business and making some profit while he's at it. So let's try and get some mics in the audience. Can I see a hand? Please tell us. You can make a short comment and a question, but I would really prefer a question. And tell us who you want it to be answered. Do I see any hands here? Okay, is that how badly we are keeping you from lunch? Okay, finally, we got lucky. Okay, the first questioner gets a separate coupon. I'm making a request to the IDSA to provide a small goodie bag to the first question. Go ahead, sir.
My name is Kabir Dhingra. I'm from DXN Marketing India Private Limited. I've been with this company for past 18 years as a networker, as a consumer come distributor. This IDSA is what we all networkers and the entire Indian network looks forward, because we see as a body which will represent all of us. Because India being a big country, all our problems you have undertaken and you can share it with the governments and all that. My only concern is, since it's a big industry, how about building the image of direct selling industry in India? It's a big country and anything needs a lot of money. And we have big companies, IDSA companies. If we just pull in some money and we create an awareness among the masses, that come on, don't make your children a doctor or an engineer. Why don't you make that child a direct seller?
Point taken. I think
you
captured
it
well.
It should be advertised extensively all over India.
I would leave it to Mr.
And we have social media. So many medias are available. Create an awareness.
Absolutely. I think the IDSA office bearers most certainly will perhaps respond. I know that there is AGM and the executive committee election, and if there is somebody who wants to add to this from the panel here, please feel free, or we can get somebody from the association later on to respond. You want to take that? Yeah, go ahead.
I think the things are changing now. We see a lot of good people who are educated, who are in different sectors. They're coming down to becoming direct sellers and doing a good business now. And even companies, it's a good suggestion. We can always talk to IDSA that how we can all collaborate and run a campaign, maybe in the social media or maybe in the newspaper, whatever, and get, you know, create a better image or bigger image of the direct selling company. It's a very good idea. But things are changing tremendously, because I've seen from last 10 years the kind of people now we have who are coming to the company and joining in the company are far better than before it was.
Absolutely, and I think there is...
I'll just add one few,
yeah,
because
quickly,
you can ask any of these leaders here, because they have huge networks.
Yes.
It's not easy to share an opportunity with an unknown person. It's not easy. So we expect that this industry's image, we have to build it. We have to make it really that this is the industry which is empowering women, which is empowering youngsters, and it is an honest industry.
I would concur with that, sir. Do you want to add to that?
Yeah,
yeah.
The one
that. Yeah, now it's working.
You know, it's an excellent question. I will say that question is asked to when I made reference to 62 DSAs. Probably there are over 62 markets. That question is asked in all 62 markets. Hmm. It's a question that's asked every day in the United States, Australia, New Zealand, Canada, everywhere. And part of that answer is, and I'd like to turn it around, is why do we have a bad reputation? And I think you have to sort of approach that. What is it, the impediment? It isn't that people don't really know about it. It's because there are scams. There was a reference earlier to Ponzi schemes. We have the Honorable Code Administrator here. I had the pleasure to chat with her during this session. Is in promoting reputation, it has to be earned. And earning that reputation is one of the reputable things you do, and then attacking the and showing the industry willing to attack the bad actors, taking stance against. In the U.S., we're now enforcing our regulations on non-members of our DSA. We're taking it to a step further. So that reputation is earned by taking action, frankly, against our own members when they don't behave correctly, to instill that consumer. It only takes one complaint. There's some statistic that shows that one complaint, even in this hotel, has more of an impact than 10,000 compliments.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So policing the industry, I'm not saying there are significant problems here, and then attacking those illegitimate schemes that do exist that tarnish the image of the good companies.
Absolutely, and yes, ma'am, let's get a mic here. Let's get a mic here, please.
I was just wondering whether this question would be relevant or not in this, but as Mr. Franco just said, and we've got a lot of direct sellers over here, the companies and all, can we not tell the companies that do not lure members from or the agents from other companies? Because then there's having a lot of problems, and the companies themselves are they're saying that he's taken away this company, this person has been taken away, and now ours has gone down. So can we not kind of form some kind of a rule or something that if
you
the
complaints mean,
like that,
you mean a no poaching kind of
As Mr. Franco was just saying that also. So
okay, that's a curveball you have thrown at us.
Right now, that's most important.
I want you to respond
to
that. Okay. No, and a great point. It really is a great point. The brave man
very,
on my left.
I think that's a very relevant question, and I think that's the easiest way out. That all of us decide that nobody joins from any other company. But what we also have to keep in mind is this is a free business. Right, the people who are doing our business are doing it voluntarily.
They are not contractual employees.
Yeah, they're not contractual employees, or not. They're not under any obligation. So,
yeah, but there must be some kind of when
so
they are giving.
The solution probably could be that as each organization works on building its network very, very strongly, And I'll agree to you when you say that it is at times important to take action against your own people when they are not promoting the business in the right sense. Because people join this industry to make a career. I'm sure all of my distributor friends sitting here, you're not joining any company for 6 months or 1 year or 2 years. You're joining here to make a life. And before I go to other companies, it becomes my responsibility as a company to ensure that I give you a good life. I give you an assurance that I'll always follow the law and help you gain everything that you have come for. Because you have, to your question, it's not about or. So I would not ask my child to join direct selling and not become a doctor. The beauty of direct selling is it's a and business. You can be a doctor and you can still be a very, very successful direct seller. And that's what I'd like to promote. So you're very right. The ownership is on companies, but I think first we need to work internally, and then definitely there'll be a stage where we can do all those things.
Thank you.
But when you get the agent, isn't it right in the beginning some kind of terms and conditions that you cannot do this or you do that? That has to be. I mean, you may not be giving a
totally,
salary or something.
But the solution which you are saying requires two companies to have a
so that if you can set a rule amongst the companies.
Well, ideal, but may not be very
okay. Let's get the mic here. I just want to add that you know, other sectors have tried it in India, and you know that courts have not upheld it at all. Please use the mic.
I don't know if it's this close. Very much. And I'm not tech savvy, so my technology. To the colleague's point, and I share the administrator's view, is yes, these are independent people. They're not your employees. But in the United States, at least, a company cannot hide behind the independent contractor defense, which means you have an obligation to set forth the conduct of the direct sellers. It can't simply be say, well, they're out there doing these things and interfering, for example, bringing in other people, misrepresenting the opportunity, saying you can make a lot of money here, you can make more money here. They're free agents. It's a free country. India's a free country. You can stop selling tomorrow and sell something else. But that's a little different question. The question was a very good question, is what are you doing as companies to police your own sales force to make sure the sales force is complying with your policies? And the answer can't be, well, they're just independent.
A code of conduct. Sir.
I think it just filled a little bit of a gap here, because the term that we're talking about is systematic enticement. This is where the company sponsors or encourages recruitment of people from another company within the membership. That is provided for as a term that can be put into your code of ethics now. It's there. It requires, obviously, to be within the law of your country. So if, for example, your law would prohibit that, then you wouldn't be able to put it in there. We have that in New Zealand. We have that term available. And if somebody starts going after another company's sales force, whether it's as an individual distributor trying to recruit others, and it's a deliberate and systematic process, then they can complain to the code administrator, and their membership of the DSA is at jeopardy in that situation. It is about the DSA being able to enforce that rule, and as you as the code administrator are able to actually say, okay, well, the rule is there. If I get a complaint, I will look at it and I will administrate it on that basis, and yes, that member might not be a member of the DSA going forward. So there is opportunity there.
But yes, that's true, but I think the question is a different question, if I can, Garth. I think there are two points here. One is what Garth is referring to as a systematic Salesforce rating as a company-driven activity. But I think your point is different, which is individual direct sellers, independently, there is no systematic enticement to join, but individual direct sellers are making misrepresentations about that. That is, I think, a challenge for companies. There's no question about policing it, and that is probably putting aside those instances where a company decides as a matter of policy that it's going to go and raid, that is what's prohibited by the code. Individuals
are something that the company needs to police to make sure that they're not doing interfering with contracts. It's called tortious interference with a contract of another direct seller, or they're misrepresenting the opportunity. So I think there are two issues.
Yeah, absolutely.
And if I may add, there are not strictly, yes, I'll come to you. How much time do we have? Can we take, okay, just that one last, let's get a mic there at the end. That there is a comparable sort of situation in the mobile phone industry. That's organized retail, not completely comparable. And I think there are some lessons that can be had from there. But I would venture, and you know, pardon my ignorance here, I have seen other sectors in this country have strong self-regulatory architectures that develop out of their associations, including in the telecom space, to some extent in the electronic space. Maybe it's time for IDSA to take that next step as the next growth opportunity. Yeah, okay, yeah. We have one comment okay. there, and I'll come to you, Rajat, for the last one here.
Okay,
quickly,
good afternoon,
sir.
I'm Tarun. The biggest challenge for direct selling companies and right nowadays is the e-commerce websites. So that is the threat. They are stealing our rights. And as a IDSA, there should be there are the law of the land. They should not.
The room that has finally come out. Thank you for raising that. I know it's I was having that conversation, but it's a good point. Let's also take that comment. I want others, more people to comment on this, sir. Let's get the mic at the end, please. If you could stand up, it will be easier to see it.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm the lawyer in the room. I'm practicing the Supreme Court. But I'll not like to limit it to the law here because we've already spoken a lot on the law. We were talking about the role for the awareness. So in India, there is this whole institution of AMFI, which has created a lot of awareness about mutual funds.
Yes.
So similarly, there could be something for the IDSA on those lines and the commercial lines. And being a lawyer, however, I believe that all the legal issues are taken care of if your commercials go up. If our industry becomes a 1 trillion rupee industry, that will really sort out most of the. So my question to you, Franco, is that based on the American best practices which you've seen, and as the Indian industry is now moving ahead and it's endeavoring to become a 1 trillion rupee industry, we have leapfrogged in many sectors. So if you see in India, the telecom story in India has been, we've directly moved to mobiles. We've not gone through the landline phones. In broadband, we've directly moved to 4G. We have not gone through. So what do you think is the leapfrogging moment for the direct selling industry in India, wherein we could directly move ahead based on the best practices as we're moving towards that $1 trillion figure in India?
Yeah, that was meant for you.
Okay, two things I would say. Something we've done in the United States in terms of leapfrog, and that is to create that consumer confidence and regulatory confidence, is to have a very strong self-regulatory body. You have it in the code administrator here, but in the U.S. we have an independent body that's moderate, quite expensive, quite elaborate, that works in conjunction with the government through a memorandum of understanding. So it would take, I think, a massive effort, quite frankly, by the IDSA, and I'm happy to speak offline, we don't have time today, what we've done in the U.S. with our self-regulatory council, which again is an expensive endeavor,
yes,
that encompasses both members and non-members. To address all the abuses that are happening in the marketplace, which are generally and more acute with the non-members. And that is in collaboration with the government. That will then address things like, since you're a lawyer, the Chits and Price Act here in India, and
yes,
other impediments we've had that are significant. And I think there's been limited movement if that can be done. That's the first and I think most important step that can be taken to really create that confidence.
Okay, great point, Rajat.
Yeah. Hi, this is Rajat here. This is a question for Adolfo and connected to the question that the gentleman asked. I was talking to Siddharth some time back and he asked this question that, look, with e-commerce opening up and, you know, Amazons of the world being very, very aggressive and very with deep pockets, what is your observation of how direct selling entities and companies globally are, you know, morphing themselves to tackle this thing of e-commerce as such?
Shoot, I shouldn't get all the questions. I get all the hard questions. This really should be a domestic question. No, no. These are the how do you solve? I'll give you my honest opinion. And again, your colleagues here are better suited because they're really doing the business. I'm doing it as Garth and Julian Tamuna. We're doing it and Chayton. We're doing it from the association standpoint. So we have a perch to see everything, but we're not living it. My personal opinion, and that there's all due respect, is life isn't fair. And what I mean by that is it's an evolving marketplace. It's the same thing as people in the US years ago asked, why can't the government protect the train system? No one takes trains in the US today. It's all airplanes. The e-commerce question, and I'm not talking about abuse, things like Amazon in the US and so forth, fraudulent products and so forth. I'm talking about the e-commerce model is just an evolution. Just like social media is an evolution for direct selling and the way the selling is done, I believe that our companies will evolve into e-commerce and then start to embrace e-commerce. And frankly, many companies will become e-commerce. And I can't speak out of turn here, but I know this for a fact, some of the largest well-known names in the US are seriously, quietly exploring this. It could even be a situation where there is a hybrid of activity, just as though people, and I'm taking a lot of time here, I know 30 years ago thought it was the end of direct selling when the internet was evolved. And before that, direct selling, if you all remember, and at least in the US, our motto has a little house. Direct selling used to be Avon, ding dong, Avon calling, people knocking on doors. No one does that. The industry evolved. And I think we will evolve into e-commerce in some shape, way, or form. You cannot fight it. You cannot fight technology. You cannot fight changes in the marketplace.
Wonderful. I want the panel here to respond to this because we had this discussion, and it would be wrong to assume that the youngster who is becoming a first-time buyer by tapping his phone screen will also meet a direct seller. I think the chances of him meeting a direct seller in his consumption cycle are negligible versus him buying every day a few times from the phone. So from the panel, a couple of responses, and then we'll wrap it up for today.
So 2 points here is that, you know, if you can't fight it, be with them is the only, you know, answer to this, which we clearly realize and, you know, we feel. And, you know, very frankly, what Franco said is the thought process where many companies are doing it and are in that direction. So I think eventually what's going to happen is that, be it Amazon or any other, but ultimately the consumer is what you have to look at and who's doing it. So is the direct seller getting benefit out of it or not? So two eventualities is what we have to evolve in our own system of the structure that we create. The second is somewhere on the legal question is that we, like IDSA, needs to be a self-regulatory organization now, which will help us in leapfrogging what we really need to do. Once that happens, eventually what we're going to see is a standard operating regulatory law amongst all the companies, wherein we can also share information and database for the rogue direct sellers that we see eventually where the bad name comes from.
Yes.
That will help us in sharing the database, sharing the information. And the direct selling bad name really comes from where? The company does not promote the bad name. It is always the people who adopt that practice which makes the bad name, and what the company takes steps to, you know, against those people is what really comes out to be. So before we really go to an SRO model, is what model do we have to restrict our people and take action against those people as an individual company?
I have two more responses from the panel and two ladies standing, so we'll take their responses, but at the end, go ahead, sir, and I'll come to you also.
Just one point here as far as internet selling is concerned, e-commerce is concerned. I think India is the only country where government has come out with some restriction on internet selling through their guidelines. And I would thank IDSA Executive Committee for that, to do that particular thing. But they have a line there which says that a direct seller has to take a permission to sell. And now we have gone to the level, all of you might be knowing because it comes on the paper and all, that few of the IDSA companies have gone to the court, they have got a positive reply. Amazon has gone back to Supreme Court, and Supreme Court decision will be sort of a law. So India is the only country where this type of things are happening. I don't think any other country anywhere IDS, direct selling associations or otherwise, they have any control over the internet selling company. So I think we should give a big hand to the IDSA team.
Just add up to about the e-commerce model. In fact, direct selling is all about fusion sales. And we have already adopted, innovated, and renovated ourselves. And to a large extent, we talk about the distribution model. We also follow a practice of e-commerce. So we have adopted it as part of our enterprise. But yes, there is a problem with the way Amazon is doing it, others are doing it. For that, as Manoj talked about, we are already going into that front also, so that the interest of the direct sellers are protected. But yes, at the same time, every company is also trying to digitize itself, because in terms of the distribution of the product, in terms of ordering system, in terms of the learning management system to train the distributors. So this is a process that we have to build up, and we cannot avoid technology. Ultimately, at the end of the day, direct selling is all about high touch factor with a high tech factor also. Maybe we are the originators of the social network, but now it has gone to the Facebook and others, which is known more. But yes, over a period of time.
I love that line, high touch, high tech. That's a great headline, yeah.
I know we're short on time, but these were excellent observations. And I think the clarification is, when we say e-commerce, what are we talking about? Because sometimes we're talking about a tool, we're talking about an evolution of how goods are being marketed. And the other times we're talking about the Amazon phenomena and competition and so forth. There are distinctions to be made. But the e-commerce, which is, I believe, the future, one of the U.S. CEOs, Ryan Napierski of Nu Skin, said in the past Nu Skin was about the Nu Skin opportunity. Now, as you mentioned, it's the customer. The customer is going to define direct selling.
Yes.
It's the customer and really, ultimately, the consumer, that's what he's talking about. Not even the direct seller, the consumer is defining. Now, at breakfast, Gillian Stapleton here, have you been introduced from the Australian DSA, was showing me this morning a U.S. company that is all an app. This young woman set this up, and she has set up an e-commerce. It's a direct seller. It's an e-commerce business that is now completely run out of an app. That is the future. That is the future of Amway, Nu Skin, all of the companies of Avon. It has to be the future. If not, we'll be left behind.
A biryani company is already doing it in India, but I'll leave that for later. Go ahead, ma'am. Very quickly, we are completely out of time, and then I'll come to you. Just quick comments.
Yeah, just I'm Manjula Lama. I'm from Avon since last 22 years. What my question was, if IDSA would help us out, because you know, over the years we have realized that the management, whenever it shifts its portfolio and goes to the different direct selling market, they have a database. So that is where the problem starts, really, okay, as far as poaching is concerned. So there should be a rule which says
And I think in the next session should respond
so
to all of these. We missed you here. So you've got a lot
say
more.
Say, for example, a MD or a lower level management is transferring the job and going to a other direct selling market.
Takes everything.
Give him a break of 2 years before he does that.
Wow.
Because
good one.
Yeah, because the database is all with them. And yes, they do at their level try their best to get into
the lawyer in the room. The lawyer in the room is smiling to that suggestion. Okay, ma'am, and that's the last point because we are completely out of time. Lunch beckons.
Yes, I'm Pami Sachdeva. I'm from Amway, and I've been associated with Amway since last 21 years. And I would totally agree with ma'am, and I just say one thing, that if together we are, as an organization of IDSA, we start respecting each other.
Yes.
There's market for everybody in this country. Everybody has place here. So if somebody is talking negatively about another company, we should immediately, the company should take a stand on it. And in this, and in fact, if you go on YouTube, just to promote their product, they are trying to put down the other companies. And it is not about expensive and cheap. There's market for everybody. There's a cheap car, there's an expensive car. So let the customer pick up the product what they want to. And we should, as total, we should respect each other.
Absolutely.
If somebody is a direct seller, we should say, yes, go ahead. And there's nothing about poaching, because I feel we should give respect. That's
absolutely, and I'm going
to,
okay, really quick one there. Can I get that mic here, please? Quick. Yeah.
Vijay.
Yeah, just.
He's coming.
Yes,
Again, I love the panel. It's absolutely fantastic, the whole event. I just want to point out, this is simple, what you are mentioning, those are the simple points that are mentioned in every DSA's code that every member company has to adhere. So if you see something, bring it to the attention of the code administrator. Denigration is point in if it's so obvious, because poaching is something, it's hard to prove why you poach, right? But denigration, you know, exaggerated earnings, it's all in the code. So I would really urge all of you, if you see this, to bring it up to the attention of the DSA and the code administrator, because if you have proof, it can be proved.
Absolutely.
And the company will be warned, and then if it does it again, then it's violating the code and can be expelled from membership.
Okay, that's a wonderful discussion that we had, and I would just like to say that your industry is at the cusp of a massive opportunity, and obviously only those industries which prevent governments making their laws and which manage to keep the government at bay and self-regulate and have a good brand and a good architecture flourish in an Indian environment. If you're going to depend on the government, then you'll also have to depend on many other things which are perhaps left unsaid. So I'm going to wish you all the very best for good sales. And as a customer, I would really end by saying that I would love to have ease of buying on e-commerce, because that's where the future lies. So keep that in mind. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I would like everybody to stay here on the stage. Stay here on stage, all the panelists. So before we end, we have two things. Obviously, a thank you address by our Secretary Rajat Banerjee, and post that we have a facilitation for each of our panelists. Rajat, a thank you speech by you. Is it a surprise?
Well, I have a very long thank you speech. It consists of two words, thank you. But jokes apart, I have a speech. Even that's a joke, actually. But thank you very much to the panel. Very interesting discussion. Thank you, the audience, for some reasonably bright questions. And, you know, the fact remains that we've been, you know, trying to answer these questions for more than 22 years, you know. And the issues that face us today, we are lucky in the sense we can tap into Franco's, you know, knowledge to, we can call in the World Federation, Tamuna and the others, to learn from it. And yes, do take your point, Siddharth, that look, be careful what you ask for, what regulation you ask for. And unfortunately, you know, when we started this work about 10, 12 years back, most of the government departments are shocked and they're asking, why do you guys want regulation? Most industry do not want regulation. But I think this audience knows, we all know that we were kind of clubbed in with money circulation schemes, which we are not. So had that one act, which Adolfo did mention some time back, the price chits money circulation scheme, not been around, I think we would have been the true free market example. This is something that doesn't cost anything. Anyone can join. Everyone can sell. Everyone can earn. It should have been a win-win. And we saw the figures. You know, India, we lag way, way behind. So well, that is my thank you speech. And thank you once again. And here I just like to call out Vivek. Terrific show. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rajat. So I would like to invite Mr. Jitendra Jagota, our treasurer, to give a token of appreciation to all the panelists. And I would request Tarandeep and Monica to help with the mementos. Yeah. Could you first present it to Mr. Siddharth Zarabi? Yeah, of course. Okay. Mr. Adolfo Franco, yeah. Tarandeep Idaraja. And a big round of applause, because it was quite engaging. Thank you. Abhichandani. And Mr. Satya Patya. Can we have a group picture? Everybody is standing here. Siddharth, you can come in the middle. Positivity from the minister, and thank you, Siddharth, for your valuable time. I would request everybody to join us for lunch. Thank you.